Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City on the weekend. You can't see the mess because I've kind of controlled where the camera's pointing. But anyway, the shop's a mess and it's going to be that way for a while because it is a busy working shop and that's the way it goes. And we don't even have professional lighting. We just got all the lights on. There you go. So today, it's an interesting topic that there's an endless demand or hunger for information, answers, knowledge, whatever. Today it's going to be, what are we going to call it? Why afterburners, or afterburner what and why, something like that. Anyway, I've got a bunch of books that I like and I've shown you before. This is kind of a complimentary video to one I made recently, which basically just showed a bunch of footage of afterburners, reheat and post-combustion. The video is called Afterburner Reheat and Post-Combustion. Imagine that. Anyway, it starts off with a bit of a blurb thanking a school that sent me some goodies that I was using some today. And at about, well, you read the info, at about 6 minutes in, it just is non-stop afterburner footage for about 20 minutes. So refer to that one. And we're going to use some very short clips from that video and a few others recycled in today's video because recycling's good and afterburner footage is pretty hard to get. Anybody who thinks that I need to get closer or need to stabilize the camera more or blah, blah, blizz, blahs, and what a, they have no idea what they're asking because you may as well be trying to get close-ups of the inside of the roof of the mouth of a Tyrannosaurus Rex, if they existed at this time. It's big and it's dangerous and it's so loud that it rips your face off. Literally rips your face off. No, it figuratively rips your face off. It's, I have tried many times to describe the unbearable, unbelievable noise and I've always failed. So if you haven't seen one in real life, you have no idea what it's like, even if you watch all my videos on it. Anyway, okay, let's pick one of my, This is the book that inspired this video. It's available from the Rolls-Royce Heritage Trust. It's called Fast Jets. Can you see that? Okay. Now this was sent to me by an appreciative viewer, and it's actually an old library book. So I contacted the library in somewhere in England. I forget what it's called. A little town, a nice little town. Derbyshire, and Afton. Is it Afton? Let's just see. Afton. No, it was Alfreton. Alfreton. Okay. And the library in Alfreton said, "No, we don't have a record of it, so we must have liquidated it or sold it." Blah blah blah. So anyway, I can keep it. I don't have to send it back. And on the first page. First page, let's read this. And the reason I like to read this is because it's an excellent description of what the whole point is of burning so much fuel in the jet pipe. So, the constraints on turbine inlet temperature caused by turbine metallurgical limitations, this was way back in the day when they didn't have quite the advanced materials we do now, but this is still true. Restricted the gross thrust of early jet engines, and it was recognized that some form of thrust augmentation, it's often called that still today, would be needed to provide additional thrust for interceptor aircraft, both for takeoff and from short fields or aircraft carriers, and for climb and combat. Rocket assistance was tried, but the very high fuel consumption limited its use. In addition, special propellants were required together with dedicated tankage. Yes, water methanol injection into the inlet of the compressor proved satisfactory on centrifugal compressor engines, but the need for special tankage and pumps was an installation liability. And water's heavy, and if you have as much jet fuel as you possibly can stuffed into your F-105 low-level nuclear bomber, you've got to take away some of that space for fuel to put water in there. And yeah, and the fact that you can push water, methanol, into the engine means you burn even more fuel because the temperature's lower and, well, you've got less fuel, but you're burning more, so your range is really limited. Anyway, so it says they tried that, and it was used in some aircraft. The B-52 uses JT-3s, and they have water injection, I believe, which really increases the black smoke production on takeoff, but it does boost power. And there's a lot of room in a B-52 for fuel and water and other things. The bigger you get, the more stuff you can carry. That works with airplanes, ships, and everything. Funny that. Okay. Reheating the turbine exhaust gas in the jet pipe resulted in an increased jet velocity and reduced gas density. To maintain the air mass flow with a reduced density, the final nozzle area had to be increased. Which allowed the increased jet velocity of the maintained air to flow to provide increased gross thrust. The heat was added by burning fuel. Goes on and on. Okay, so we're trying to explain, why does the nozzle open up? Why does the nozzle open up in Afterburner? Why does it do that? Okay, let's move to another book. We have a book that a lot of people think that I don't like, but actually it is a really good book. It's by Bill Gunston. He's not always wrong, he's almost always right. And it's a really good book, and he's a really good writer. So, Afterburning. He says, it was noted earlier that variable area and condi, convergent, divergent nozzles, are essential if thrust is boosted by burning additional fuel in the jet pipe. This is called afterburning, or in Britain, reheat. And I've heard other people from around the world call it post-combustion, which is my favorite way to call it. I call it afterburning, but post-combustion I think is pretty cool. The abbreviation AB is often used for both the afterburner and the process. The percentage increase in thrust is called augmentation, and the word is often particularly applied to a reheat turbofan, the jet pipe then being termed an augmenter. Yes. Another variation is a duct heater, which provides augmentation by burning fuel in the fresh air in the fan duct, but not in the flow from the core. I don't know of any engine that does this. I know that there was a, what do they call, induct burning for the Pegasus engine in the Harrier. The little afterburners were at the end of the delivery pipes to the wingtips and at the tail, little nozzles that helped the attitude control of the Harrier. They weren't for the main exhaust nozzles. There's a cold and a hot, two cold exhaust nozzles and two hot exhaust nozzles that provide the main thrust and forward vectoring in a Harrier. And then there's little jets on the wingtips and at the tail. And there was called induct burning. There were little afterburners in there. And I don't think that they ever did use that. It was a little impractical and dangerous. I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure they didn't use them on a regular basis. Whatever the words use, afterburning always results in a tremendous increase in fuel consumption, so that the specific fuel consumption, which is pounds of fuel per hour per pound of thrust, that's specific fuel consumption, and you can replace any unit of weight or mass for pound. You can go kilograms. Kilograms is a unit of mass, so you'd have to convert the kilogram attraction of gravity to weight. And anyway, fuel consumption is units of fuel per hour per unit of thrust. Yeah. So on a J79 turbojet without afterburner, it's about one pound of fuel per pound of thrust per hour. And when you flip on the afterburner, it goes to almost 3. Quite a large drop in fuel mileage for a 50% increase in thrust. So, afterburning is possible for two main reasons. There are no turbine blades to limit temperature of the gas flow, which is good. So your what would you call it, EGT of the afterburner could be literally flame, and it is. When you see a afterburning combat jet, it's like, wow, look at that, the fire coming out the back. The EGT is probably 3,500 degrees because the gases don't have to encounter any metal parts. Even the liner of the jet pipe and the nozzle itself has got a layer of air between it and the actual flame. And that's the magic of jet engines, is cooling air. We've covered that before. You can always look in my search bar on my channel page for cooling air and find some cool stuff there. A variable jet nozzle, a variable area nozzle, is essential that the area being increased to handle the expanded jet volume. When you heat up the gases in the afterburner, with the extra fuel and the extra heat, you heat them from around 800 degrees to probably, let's just say 2800 degrees. You add 2000 degrees of temperature, and so they expand. There's no actual combustion chamber. They're not enclosed or captured. There's a wide open hole in the back of the engine. So you heat up the gases by 2000 degrees, they expand a lot. And so now they want to travel a lot faster. And, okay. If this were not done, the jet pipe pressure would be greatly increased. So you've got the military thrust, it's about, on the J79, you can see in the footage, it's it can't go out the back end any faster. And so the pressure goes up, and that begins to affect the efficiency of the turbine. If the pressure goes up high enough in the jet pipe because of a closed nozzle and the temperature going up, you're gonna melt parts in the jet pipe, but also the turbine is gonna slow down. It's gonna lose power. And then when the turbine loses power, everything slows down. It's not what you want your engine to do. It's not happy. All right, so the earliest afterburner jet pipes were relatively simple on-off units. The pilot could move the power lever, or the throttle, all the way forward to obtain maximum thrust, in the USA called military. If necessary, he could then rock the lever outboard and move it a short way further forward. The AB would light with a muffled explosion. The nozzle would suddenly open fully, and the pilot would experience what an F-100 Super Sabre pilot once called a kick from a well-fed mule. Soon designers did better, the British inventing part throttle reheat, the US designers modulated afterburning. This gives a smooth increase in thrust all the way from flight idle to maximum reheat, with nozzle area and profile being modulated along with the fuel flow to suit the requirements of each throttle setting. Yes, now, the engines we work on either have fixed nozzles because they don't have afterburning, like the Arendas, or they have the sophisticated variable exhaust nozzle modulated in the J79. We don't have any examples of the eyelid type two position nozzle, but there's a really good video on YouTube, and it's of a Saab Draken. Anyway, it's a Rolls-Royce Avon with two position eyelid type nozzle, and they're switching it in and out of afterburner. It's very cool. I'm sure you can find it. There is not a link for it in my video because I don't know the link. Oh, actually, I might put a link in the description, but you shouldn't need a link. If you're interested in aviation and you want to do it, have anything to do with it, or if you want to build your own engine or learn more about it or get a job working on engines of any kind, you should be resourceful. You should say, I want to find out about that, and then start finding it. And you'll probably find that within two or three or maybe four steps, each of those steps taking a minute, you'll find it. So if you need a link to buy me a jet engine, you're helpless and you're hopeless. So I'll put a link in the description, but you know what I'm saying. Okay, so again, I showed you the book, this one. Let's go to the next one. It's just a general shop practices handbook by GE, probably for their employees, 1972. It's got a picture of a CF6 on there. That's the engine that we used in the turbofan parts donor and the aircraft engine turbine land engine series. It's also the engine that the fan blade was taken out of to give away. Anyway, this is a cool little thing that I found in a old crate of books. So according to GE, afterburner. An afterburner is a secondary combustion section behind the main engine which further increases the gas temperature and therefore its volume and velocity. They don't talk about pressure, do they? This velocity increase is what increases the thrust output of the engine. Flame holder, a device inside the afterburner near the forward end, which creates an area of turbulence for flame propagation. It also creates an area of low gas velocity to hold the flame in the forward end of the tailpipe so that all combustion takes place inside the tailpipe. Well, I guess most, because when the flame is spitting out the back of your F-16, it looks great, it looks awesome. Or the F-22 ripping by with those two huge columns of flame coming out the back. The incandescent carbon particles makes the color, and so they're burning outside the engine. That combustion outside the engine and outside the nozzle is somewhat wasted. Sure looks cool, and those engines are very efficient, but they're getting better all the time, and they're not perfect. Otherwise, the most efficient afterburner you could see would have no flame coming out the back of the plane, and that wouldn't be any fun. Okay, variable exhaust nozzle. An exit nozzle on a jet engine with a variable area, so the area can be adjusted to balance the pressure and temperature in the tailpipe. During AB operation, the nozzle must be open to prevent turbine overpressure and overtemperature. Yes. So if you build up pressure behind the turbine, you will slow the turbine down because the turbine functions on velocity of flowing through it. So you need a higher pressure in front of it than at the back of it, otherwise the gas won't flow through. So if you increase the pressure behind the turbine, it's losing power, and that's not good. Losing power to give to the compressor, and the compressor needs a lot of power to compress that air. So if you kept the nozzle closed and fed fuel into the afterburner, everything gets hot. So you want to avoid that. Let's see. Another book this is a very intense book for, it's meant for engineering students, I believe. It says it's for the interested amateur, but honestly, I've shown you this before, right there, that one, Jack Mattingly. Oh, everything's backwards, okay. Elements of gas turbine propulsion. So he says, there's a little chapter here, a little paragraph called The Ideal Turbojet with Afterburner. The thrust of a turbojet can be increased by the addition of a second combustion chamber, he calls it, or they call it, called an afterburner, aft of the turbine, as shown in figure 5.10. I'll show you that in a second. Total temperature leaving the afterburner has a higher limiting value than the total temperature leaving the main combustor, because the gases leaving the afterburner do not have a turbine to pass through. Here we go. So, this little tiny diagram. Right there. Isn't that cool? You can probably stop and read it. That's pretty cool. Yeah. Okay, so we've got descriptions of the afterburning section of the turbojet by several books and the function of the nozzle. Let's see. I think we have one more. I've shown you this before quite recently. Aircraft Power Plants, published by McGraw-Hill. By Thomas Wilde and Michael Crows. Okay, they say something that I like. It says, with a convergent type of nozzle, a waste of energy occurs since the gases leaving the exit do not expand rapidly enough to immediately achieve outside air pressure. Some high pressure ratio engines use a convergent divergent nozzle to recover some of this wasted energy. This nozzle utilizes... the pressure energy to obtain a further increase in gas velocity and consequently to increase thrust. Okay, convergent, divergent. Yeah. Right there. See? You can freeze that and read it too, I think, if I hold it still enough. Here we go. When combustion takes place in the afterburner, the gases are speeded up, increasing the temperature and thrust. With the afterburner in operation, the jet nozzle area must be increased. Otherwise, back pressure would increase at the discharge of the turbine and result in a temperature rise of the gas in the vicinity of the turbine beyond a permissible safe limit. It'll get too hot, it'll start to melt and get damaged, and that'll be bad. With the variable area nozzle, the size of the exhaust area can be changed by opening the nozzle, increasing the size of the opening. The temperature of the exhaust gases can be reduced and kept within allowable limits. So the nozzle area controller in the J79, it varies exhaust nozzle size based on the temperature in the afterburner. So the temperature controls this, not the speed of the gases or the pressure in the pipe, but the temperature. You lower the temperature by opening the exhaust nozzle. The nozzle may be operated electrically, hydraulically, or pneumatically. So in the J79, they're operated hydraulically. Funnily enough, I got one question this morning to do with afterburners. And it says, hello, I have a question. What causes the crackling sound of an afterburner? Can you clarify that to me, please? Well, the afterburner noise is just the same kind of noise as the jet exhaust, just more of it, more of a ripping sound. And the best way to describe it is the atmosphere is basically nominally still. There's wind and there's movement and air does move around. That's what weather is. But it's basically, let's say its velocity is below 50, say 30 miles an hour, 50 kilometers an hour, most places. And now you've got an exhaust stream traveling at 1,000 kilometers an hour. That's a very large velocity difference, and it causes turbulence. It meets the relatively still air, it goes ripping by it, and it causes a great deal of turbulence and mixing, and that makes noise, it makes a cracking sound. And I've read that the crack of a whip is when the tip goes supersonic. Well, if you imagine millions of those whips going off constantly, that's what the exhaust stream of a supersonic exhaust stream of a turbojet or afterburner mixing into this basically static, not quite static, slow moving atmospheric air. It causes ripping, crackling, snapping. And the greater that difference in speeds, the more intense and I guess higher pitch the snapping and rapping and crackling is, which is why modern airliner engines, they've tried to slow down the gas flow to just about the speed of the aircraft, and they use a lot more air at lower velocities, and they're always working on sound attenuation technology, which is why when a 787 takes off, you can barely hear it. It's amazing, it's a miracle. Whereas back when I was a kid, I've said this before, like an original 707, they had turbojet engines. They moved on to low bypass turbofans, but originally they had turbojet engines and they made so much noise, thundering, crackling, ripping, snapping noise, because the super high power for takeoff is happening when the aircraft is barely moving. And so the velocity difference between the exhaust stream and the outside air was huge. And so if you measure a 707 in say 1965 to a 787 in 2019, the difference is amazing. It's just amazing. And I think that engines will keep getting quieter. Pretty soon airliners will just float around like a butterfly. Anyway, the sound is the velocity difference between the two fluids. It causes violent turbulence and tiny areas like whirlpools in a stream, tiny areas of low pressure and high pressure. And when all those, the pressure differences are also, they cause sound, because sound energy is just pressure differences in air. So a turbulent mixing of extremely high velocity streams with static streams causes pressure, chaos that resolves itself into a rumbling, crackling, snapping noise. And then it all just fades away into heat. And everything becomes calm again. Okay, that's a bit of chit-chat from the books about why the nozzle moves and how it's controlled. It doesn't explain everything. Just wanted to add a little bit of information and a little taste of all these books because there's five of them here, and I don't believe in using any one book as a source. You want to have three or four. If you've got three or four books that you've either looked at online or taken out from the library or purchased yourself, and they all kind of say the same thing, you can be pretty certain that that's what's going on. If one book says something and another book says something else, now you got a conflict. And if you just have one book saying something, to go by one book is a mistake. You need multiple sources. And that's how you will become more confident in the knowledge that is purported to be in the book. Anyway, hopefully I've interspersed enough little clips of afterburner, nozzle, actuation, and firing to make it interesting. And if you've made it this far, go watch my all footage video called Afterburner Reheat and Post Combustion. The link of that will be in the description. So thanks for watching.